words at the opening of this new theme of ours. For the next 6 weeks, we will be examining some of the biblical pointers towards a good society. And the title of our series, No Is Not Enough, you might also recognize as the title of a best-selling book by journalist Naomi Klein, published earlier this year. Naomi Klein takes a broad view of where President Trump's various initiatives are taking us as a nation. She's worried. But the point of her book is that it isn't enough just to disapprove. What we lack, she says, and it's really important, what we lack is a vibrant, inspiring vision of the alternative, of the society that we would like to live in, such that people could be inspired by that and could mobilize around it for action. That's what intrigued me, that positive, constructive project of identifying an alternative future that would capture the imagination of the American people and enable us to move, hopefully quickly, in a truly hopeful direction. And that made me think about another book that I've read. It's called Rebuilding the Foundations, written by the father and son team of Walter and John Brueggemann. Walter Brueggemann is an Old Testament scholar. For my money, he's the greatest Bible teacher currently alive. And the book is a dialogue between him and his son John, who is a sociologist. John makes observations and analyzes different aspects of our society. And then Father Walter shines an Old Testament spotlight on those issues, gives us biblical insights, what the Bible says about them. So, if over these weeks you're interested in reading along, those are two books you might want to lay your hands on, especially the one by the two Brueggemanns. And I will do my best over this time to bring their work to life for us. Biblical themes that give us what we need to construct an alternative future which is inspiring to people and which can enable our nation to thrive. I want to say up front that I have an ulterior motive as well, and that is to put the Old Testament before you in all its glorious, radical, subversive wonderfulness, and hopefully enable you to see how the Old Testament can still be scripture for us as it was for Jesus. So our first reading today is from the book of Deuteronomy, which is in the Old Testament, from chapter 24, beginning at verse 10. When you make your neighbor a loan of any kind, you shall not go into his house to take the pledge. You shall wait outside while the person to whom you are making the loan brings the pledge out to you. If the person is poor, you shall not sleep in the garment given to you as a pledge. You shall give the pledge back by sunset, so that your neighbor may sleep in the cloak and bless you, and it will be to your credit before the Lord your God. You shall not withhold the wages of poor and needy laborers, whether of other Israelites or aliens who reside in your land in one of your towns. You shall pay them their wages daily, before sunset, because they are poor and their livelihood depends on them. Otherwise, they might cry out to the Lord against you, and you would incur guilt. We will sing the next of our readings. The right hand of God is writing in our land. Music is there in your bulletin. Thank you.
Desolate,
or maybe just angry, disengaged, cynical, trustful of no one. And you see how the downward spiral goes on. They don't trust us, so we don't trust them either. To my shame, I live in a gated community. We fell in love, Dale and I, with a house, and it was in one of those developments with a wall around it and a keypad out front to keep the dangerous people out. Our gate is broken right now, and so they're leaving it open all the time, and we all had a message from our homeowners association: keep your eyes open, be vigilant. If you see anybody suspicious, report them. Without our gate, anything could happen to us. This is where we start. Every society will have some degree of inequality, but the vast chasm between the haves and the have-nots that we are experiencing right now is not inevitable. It could be different. And the key is that we care, that those who are struggling can see, can feel that other people genuinely care. Not walls by which the rich protect themselves from the poor, or even islands on which you don't have to deal with it, but eye-to-eye engagement and mutual humanity. It's interesting to me that the book of Deuteronomy has no problem with an economy in which some people have more than others. Even in that short passage that we read, we saw it. We've got one person with means and another without, and an assumption that borrowing and lending is going to happen. Putting people into that have and have not relationship with each other. It's normal. And then we've got those who employ and those who offer themselves for employment, those who pay the wages and those who pocket them. Again, just assumed, normal. What is surprising is that those kinds of relationships, the haves and the have-nots, the employee and the employed, employers are limited by Deuteronomy, strictly limited. The Old Testament sets boundaries for them. Why? Because God cares. Because we are meant to care. Because your obligation is always to see beyond the system to the real human beings being impacted by it. Because underneath our different roles and whatever hard work or luck has led us to where we are in society, underneath we all share the same dignity. We all need the same things. One way that Deuteronomy talks about those limits is to distinguish the daylight hours from the nighttime. So you're rich enough that when your neighbor needs a loan, you have the means to lend. You're the bank. You give over the money, and to ensure that your neighbor doesn't renege and carries on working hard to be able to pay you back, you take a pledge. Exhibit A. This is collateral. It's a coat in this case, because it's pretty much the only thing of value that that person has. Now don't go barging into his house to seize it, the Bible says. Stand outside the door, let him bring it to you. Dignity, huh? It matters. And during the day, you hold on to the coat. Hopefully that person is working hard, scraping the money together, and it won't be long before you're all paid back. It's an arrangement that we absolutely recognize, right? We've been there. Maybe we're there right now. But then comes nightfall. Deliver the coat back to him when the sun goes down, scripture says. He needs it to keep warm. Yes, it's above and beyond to do that, but he will bless you and God will smile. It's perfectly all right if he finds you standing outside his door again first thing in the morning waiting to collect the coat back. That's the daytime relationship. At night, what matters is that he not be cold. Likewise with the employer hiring the poor laborers. Interesting that our passage explicitly puts the native Israelites alongside those strangers, those aliens, read immigrants. Before it says anything else, the passage says that the two groups are to be treated. Pay them both their wages before sunset, because they're depending on it. And this time it isn't do it out of the goodness of your heart and a poor person will bless you and God will smile. No, this time God isn't smiling. This time it's do it or else. If you don't pay those wages and a poor person has cause to cry against you to God, God is going to be on their side. Now you can see behind that rule a system like ours, where the big company can tell the little one that the check is in the mail, and the big company, meantime, can profit from holding on to that wealth a little longer while the poorer company is holding on for dear life. But it's all just part of the game, right? Winners and losers. God sees the human beings involved. We are required to care. And this isn't the sort of caring whereby we stand with bleeding hearts saying, isn't it terrible? It isn't actually about what we feel. It's about doing what's right. It's about justice. Doing the caring thing as the basis for all economic practice. It's fundamental, this, and it's a word we need to hear over and over again because the society we live in says something else. We're given an economic system to work within, and it's big and complex, bigger than most of us could ever get our heads around. And when its rules work to our benefit, as they almost always do, we say, great, I'll take it. Tax deductions, the best hospitals, thanks to our company healthcare plans, more credit available to us than we ever know what to do with, everybody competing for our favor and our business. We start to feel entitled. How could you help but feel entitled? And then we start to assume things about those other people whom the system does not favor. How they could have had it too if they just worked a bit harder. How we don't owe them anything. Who are they to us? It's all so complicated that if we just play by the rules as they've been handed to us, it's all anybody could expect. Nobody could blame us. We never have to look into the eyes of the people on the losing end of our winning if we don't have to. Let me say it again. The change that the Bible demands of us isn't about feelings. It isn't about caring in the sense that we wring our hands and feel awful and lament how helpless we are. This isn't about getting upset. It's about a fundamental caring for the dignity and value of human life, built into every law, every tax code, every set of terms and conditions, every practice, wherever money changes hands. The Bible makes it clear that this isn't about bleeding hearts, because in the Bible, it's about memory. Remember, Deuteronomy urges over and over again, once you were slaves in the land of Egypt, and God cared for you. It points back to Pharaoh's brickyards and the Hebrew slaves making bricks under Egyptian supervision, and the quotas getting pushed higher and higher every day, and then the real backbreaker, when the straw they needed, which had been delivered to the brickyard every morning, suddenly was delivered no longer, and the Israelites were told that they had to go out and find it for themselves, but no change in what was expected, no change in the quota, no increase in wages either for all that better production. There are people in our country who could identify with that. Who gets to pocket the extra wealth from that increased production? It is not often the workers. Remember, God says, remember what that felt like. Don't you ever, ever do that to anybody else. Nor is it just a matter of learning your lesson. The story that Deuteronomy celebrates is that God intervened into that situation and rescued those desperate slaves and set them back on their feet again. A defining story. Everything flows from it. Jesus gets the credit for teaching us to love our neighbor, but actually it's all there in Deuteronomy, his Bible, of course. Human dignity is God-given. And no society can flourish for very long unless it institutionalizes its caring for those struggling to survive. We love because God loved us first, the New Testament adds. Those who say, "I love God," but hate their brothers or sisters are liars. For those who do not love a brother or a sister whom they have seen cannot possibly love God whom they have not seen. The commandment we have been given is this: those who love God must love their brothers and sisters also. Recognize how radical that is in a world structured for individuals to look after themselves. Recognize how much we will have to change to reorient our society in that direction. Recognize that it starts in us with our values and assumptions. No is not enough. Our challenge is to build a yes to caring into the very heart of the new vision for our national life. Education, tax policies, regulations on banking, healthcare, security provisions, safety nets. We care, or our failure to care pits us against each other, and it all falls apart. Ultimately, we care, or we die. We are people of a hopeful project with the greatest power in the universe behind us. Our gifts are for the building up of the body of Christ in this place and for all the things that we will do together. Your offerings will now be received.